It's inside your house. It wakes you. Not a moan of a withering hag, the fleeting voice of a dead man, but the low thrill of the wind slipping past your window, air being pressed into a hushed breath. Shadows melt themselves back into your bedroom. You blink, the blurred hazy object of your alarm clock, focused back to existence. 2:48 a.m. The numbers degree. You don't want to be awake. You don't even want to keep your eyes open. Yet, here you are. Outside, the air in utter turmoil, churning up to 50 miles an hour and beating against your home. You know this was coming. In fact, you know in the moment you'd seen those thundering heads barreling in from the west, lightning forking within them. From the storm's downdraft came bursts of pine-laced wind, sharp and deceptively sweet, a destructive force carrying from the Atlantic all the way for the Barrens, a large tract of wild, unbroken wilderness you've often seen in the distance, a tall, stalky pines of its dark woods, shivering in the gills. It's been a gusty time for Jersey this year. What was it you were dreaming about anyway? Who knows? The information is already lost to the senseless grumble of thoughts trying to piece the dream back together. Gone. Although the image of falling water still rests vividly in your mind. Your bladder sends a signal to your brain, demanding relief. Half awake, you machinally saunter to the short hall to the bathroom. You flick the lights on, too bright. You rip away the thought of zigzags from your eyes. You yawn as a soul scrape over the cold towels, and you yawn again as you complete your natural business. Sweet release. You flush and lift the faucet handle to wash your hands. A sound. Your gaze flicker towards the door. You listen again. Silence. Save for occasional squeak and grind of the walls. It's probably from the breeze batting outside. Whatever it was, you're too tired to care. Glass shatters. Wakefulness spikes through you now, as this new sound resonates, crawling up from the dark downstairs. You pull a sharp inhale down your throat. Your wet hands flinch soapy pallets over the countertop. Stop. Breathe. Calm yourself. It could have been anything. Like a tree branch, or other debris that got swept up and propelled through the window. That's it. Tell yourself, nodding, hoping. A loud, powerful thought bang downstairs, and hope flees. Now muffled movement, a breaking, a burglar. Horror films you haven't seen in years slide through your mind like a celluloid movie reels. A reflection in mirror turns goosey white, contorted with fear. The police, your thoughts propose. Call the police! Your eyes trace the room for your phone. It's still lying in your bed. There's still time. You can rush back there, barricade the door, and call the police in the closet. How long will it take them to get there? Doesn't matter. Just call them. You grip the doorknob, ready to sprint straight to your room. A thump, thump, thump on the stairs freezes your limbs. Something, something fast and large, bounced down the hall. Just beyond the door, something so terrible, so lively, that even the deepest thoughts of your nightmares could never recreate this moment. Vibrations raw by your toes. Feet like heavy packs tromp up to your bedroom door. It swings open, bashing clumsily against the wall at a forced entry. You stand there, anchored to the cold tiles of the bathroom, paralyzed by shock of it all. The short space to your room fills with thrashing sounds. Bed sheets being ripped and torn asunder. The box spring squeaking and jittering violently. Your fingers, still welded to the doorknob, refuse to twist it inch further. A few steps away, something of significant size of savory guts of mattress. The place you'd been just moments ago. A cold wash starts at your chest and drips to your gown. Your breathing is now trance, as your heart pumps with new and sudden weight. Your mouth is dry, your throat rubber. Focus. There's an impulse you must hold on to. The hot blood mounting up in your throat, the intensely dilating, your pupils unlacing your eyes red. The lift in your gut from absolute freefall. These things, hardwired into your system, will keep you alive tonight. The thrashing stops. A rapid cackling emerges. High, scratchy sounds grow louder as they echo down the hallway, expelling from a mouth you dare not imagine. A cackless sputter into bleeding, like a goat coughing up mucus. Not the sound of a burglar. Not at all. The thing moves again, the hammering feet pounding to chaotic pacing, till it finally stops and settles on something. Bump, bump, bump. A succession of banging on the closet door. Why? Because it thinks that you are in there. But what is it exactly? You can't stay here. You need to leave before it finds you. The cords in your hand tighten over the handle. You mentally prepare to enter the hallway. In your periphery, your bleached reflection in the mirror verifies the struggle with that simple action, but still, the hope of escape eases the gritty feelings of leaving the small safe space. You turn the knob fully now. The door opens, thankfully, without a creak. You move quietly down the hall, light on the balls of your feet. The walls groan again as another draft clambers over them. The windows flash. The lining is so close you can hear the cracking particles. You peer back towards your room to make sure its attention hasn't left the closet. Vump. Another pound against it signals back. Much louder out here. You continue, each measured step as slow as possible. Just one sound, one little thump in the carpet. That's all it will take to alert something truly horrible. As you draw closer to the stairs, a sullen urgency pulls you to move just a little faster. You have the screaming urge to run, to barrel down the stairs and leap out the front door in nothing but your underwear. But you resist, judging by how quickly it has closed the gap from the stairs to your bed. You have no difficulty guessing who would win in a mad scramble. Not without a head start at least. A terrible crash reverberates behind you. The closet had been freed from its hinges. Heavy feet start moving again. It's coming! You kick off from your heels and practically vault the rest of the way. You round the stairs and take the first few steps. The grandfather clock that you had kept in the entryway has toppled flat on his face and now blocks the front doorway. No, not toppled. Pushed. Chunks of glass rattled the floor from the broken window in the living room. He could push the clock out of the way, open the door just enough to slide through and get out. But there's no time. The rain's shadows move down the hallway behind you. It's closing in fast. Your bare soles clap down the stairs. You reach the bottom and wind around the living room. Pain jolts up to your leg. A sharp bit of glass has prickled into your foot. The shard crunches and embeds itself deeper into the nerve. Desperate, you fall towards the coffee table and roll beneath it. Heavy stumps now bang all the way down to the bottom step. You put a hand over your mouth. You squeeze your eyes shut. Another sickish bleat croaks out of the thing. It wanders the room. Wind whips through the broken window, kicking up the drapes. Steps are loud, like the hard heels of a dress shoe, as it clacks, clacks against the hard wood. Different scents that raise your nose, a scent you can almost recognize. Something sharp and green, like being outside. Is that jewelish scent of pine needles again, now blend with a thick, murey musk, the smell of the dark woods. Each hard step sends tremors through you. Don't look, don't even take a breath, don't think of what it will do if it finds you. How vivid those thoughts teeming with horrors are. How quickly your screams will be silenced by teeth. How great the amount of blood that will pull out of your newly opened flesh, ripped and tattered like bedsheets. Do not look. But of course, you look. Your eyes negotiate with the surrounding darkness. You immediately regret looking. The deep sting of your foot no longer reaches you. The shock numbs the bulking fear welling up in your chest. Long black legs canter near you, tearing with fur. They are the legs of a winter, skinny deer capped with bony, cloven hoofs. Behind them, snakes a forked, leathery tail. A mouth you cannot see clicks its cuspids. The thing whoops loudly and then cackles like a hyena. No, your thoughts mumber, like the devil. The bony feet circle around and vanish into the gap of the kitchen. A chair scoots through, burnished, involuntarily. A shadow of things clatter onto the floor, pots and pans falling from their racks. You cautiously adjust your placement beneath the table. The pain in your soul sharpens again. Are you bleeding? Was be able to smell blood? To taste it, lingering in the air? No, if it were the case, it would have found you by now. A vision you don't feed for very long. Perhaps you can wait it out. Stay hidden until it gives up and moves on. A vain hope. It hears you run down the stairs and knows you were still here, somewhere. You allow yourself to swallow, feeling unhinged by it all. This isn't your house anymore. It is somewhere else. Some dark side of some distant planet you don't belong on. A place where something with hoofs, is stalking the halls, looking for you. The back door? Maybe. No. You recall the rollers you were starting to stick a squeak lately. Far too loud. And even if you did manage to squeeze through in time, thought of having to outrun the things fills you with immense dread. You look to the broken window. The frame is spiked with shards, waiting to slice through you in artery. Not to mention all the scattered fragments your feet will surely find again. Running will be impossible then. An idea suddenly clicks. The car keys. You left them on the kitchen counter. they should still be there, mockingly close. If you could just reach them and sneak into the garage, you can get out of there. That, you reflect, sounds like a good plan. The thing migrates from the kitchen and click-clacks down the hall, its cloven feet thump down more stairs. Basement. It must think you've gone there. That will buy you some time. Not very much, though. Out you go from the coffee table. You breathe softly, small jitters rattling your lungs. You pause a moment to brush a finger across your foot to get glass out. It works some, but you need tweezers to get the rest of those evil bits. In the kitchen, you glance about for your car keys. Some pans and a dirty skillet litter the floor. The spice rack has toppled, and a feathery art piece of garlic powder has formed on the porcelain. You move forward towards the counter with cautious steps. From the lower level, a muted crash rises up. Something else will be shoved forcefully over. Hurry! You spot the keys. You stretch out your blood-speckled fingers and curl around them, carefully lifting them as to not let them jingle in the grip. And a thought dawns on you and leads your hand next to the cutlery drawer. Sharp metal things rattle inside as you open it, much too loud for your comfort, but you find it and grab the sharpest knife there, so the noise is well worth it. Calculated risk. Having both the keys and a knife in your hands offers a small dose of victory, but you still need to make it down the hall, past the basement stairway, and to the garage. You peer down the corridor and hug the walls as you walk it. You pass by the basement quickly, imagining just for a moment something ready to screech its way out of the pitch. But in just a few paces, you've reached the doorway to the garage. You grasp for the doorknob and pull the door open. A new sound reaches from behind. A wet, acknowledging grunt. You turn. From the unseen stairway, a long, masculine neck twists towards you. Its hooves scrape into the hall. The house flakes with another stroke of lightning, giving feature to a star on forest shape. Its jagged horns extend outward, curled back into a gorish curl. Leathery skin hangs down from his thick, hairy body, hitting his backside in wrinkled folds. Eyes the color of muddy water. Eyes that have finally found you and reached out from the muddled fur. A skinless, horsey face composed of yellowed, still living bone. It clicks its teeth again, sharp, waiting. Your hand does not move from the door handle. It clenches almost tightly, as the other hand does around the knife. Both trembling, the blade is no more than a paperclip compared to the thing before you. Twitching as talons, one of your feet is already out the door, squeezed into a small crack of the garage. But there was never to be clean escape. It would never allow such a thing. The fear now settles into your legs, grasping the inside of them. It seeps into your joints, turning them into mush. Thoughts cease altogether. In the next instant, you force yourself to move, as everything else moves in rapid order. The door pulling over, hooves beating closer, a high, skirish crackle. You squeeze into the garage, chased by a hot, blast of breath, brushing up against your neck and down to your shoulder. You move to sweep the door close, but three hellish claws slip through the gap. They hook into a thin wood, propping the entry open against the leathery skin. It moves on the other end, tugging angrily at the panel. You pull against it, with every quart, every talon, burning in your forearm. You jam the keyring into your mouth, while the other hand struggles to keep hold of the knife. The thing jibs loudly on the other end. Its thick stench clings to your face. It's strong, and the presence from the grasp continues to climb. You know that it's winning. In one quick motion, you plunge the knife deep into the webbing of its talons. A horrible sound, much like the yowl of a dying cat, brays from the other side of the door. Dark, crimson blood runs down the steel and drips off the red tears. The claws retract, taking the handle with them as the door finally closes. You climb inside your car, and willingly to take another breath until the key finally finds the slot. The engine rouses to life, and all the symbols on the dash light up in green and amber. You yank the gear stick into reverse and nearly back the trunk straight into the garage door, thankfully catching yourself and clicking the opener just above your head. The door pulls open with a squeal of roller and hinges, even before the metal sheet comes to a stop overhead. You back out and slope down the street. Hands still shaking, you simultaneously switch the gear to drive and slam the hurt foot over the gas pedal. The car peels down the road, ravaging higher and higher until the house is streaked out of sight completely. You look over to the rear view, practically anticipating to see it back there, standing tall and upright beneath the street lamp. There's nothing. You've done it. You've escaped. Your white, veiny eyes find the road again, as a spasm of wind nearly knocks you over, of course. It doesn't matter where you're going, not right now anyway. All that matters is getting as far away as possible. A thin laugh shivers out of you, perhaps juvenile, perhaps just a little bit manic. You slow down a little, finally allowing some calmness to penetrate through the panic. The wind still howls and steeps over the bicycle, but as it quiets, a different sound rises behind it, like two heavy traps flopping about. You look at the side mirrors and again in the rear view. Did you just see something? A thud sounds on the roof. You take another breath and the brass, the accelerator. Thank you all so much for listening to tonight's story. Now I'd like to take a moment to thank all of my Patreons who helped make this channel possible. Thank you, Breaker19, for all your help and support. You guys are amazing.